You're the one I look to.
Okay, no problem.
Good morning. It's good to see each and every one of you here this morning. No snow, it's kind of nice for people who like to hike like me, so got in a hike yesterday. I just want to say, I appreciate our media people. I just threw stuff at them this morning, and they just do it. You know, they're the unsung heroes. They're the ones behind the scenes, and they deserve a hand. They deserve some praise for everything that they do back there. You see us all the time, but yeah, I appreciate them so much. Without them, we couldn't do what we do. So welcome if you're watching on Facebook. Let's all stand and worship and singing. Good old time, I Saw the Light.
I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Oh, I saw the light, I saw the light. No more in darkness, no more in night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I've walked in darkness, clouds over me. I had no idea of the way I could be. Then came the sun.
Should be now.
Happy!
Yesterday. Oh my goodness, we haven't seen the sun in more than a month, I think. So I was out in it I slept really good last night, all that fresh air, because we were out in that sun so much yesterday. I love the sun. I'm a person who loves actually warmth and sun. I just enjoy it very much. But as we're singing these songs, my mind focuses that even more than I love the sun and its sunlight that it gives me, I love the sun. And the light that he gives me, when life gets full of drama or life gets full of hard times, he's the one that brings refreshing to me. He's the one that brings healing to me and gives me reason for moving on. We have much to be grateful for. Life sometimes brings some hard, difficult things. But even through the hard, difficult things, we have much to praise him for. So won't you pray with me this morning as we invite his presence and his spirit into our room here. I mean, we give our presence and our awareness over to him. So, dear Heavenly Father, we just praise you. We love you. We're thankful for the sun that you gave us yesterday. We're thankful for just the ability to be outside and enjoy that sun that you gave us. But even more, we praise you for your son. We thank you for the sacrifice that he made so that we can be here in your presence, knowing that wherever we are, you are there. And because of your son, we are able to step into your presence and join you in that throne room. And we praise you for that. And so, Lord, we're praying that your spirit would fall on this service this morning, that we would engage in your presence, we would engage in these songs and lift them up before you. And letting these words follow and settle in on us and our minds and in our hearts, and aware of your presence moving this morning. We just love you, and we ask all these things in your son's name, Jesus. Amen.
I am.
pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart. Jesus, my Lord.
Pastor Jeremy.
Think of this passage in Revelations chapter 19. And I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse, whose rider is called Faithful and True. And with justice he judges and makes war, for his eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written that no one knows but he himself, and he is dressed in a white robe, dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. And the armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses, dressed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule with an iron scepter. He treads the winepress of fury and the wrath of God Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh, he has a name written. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There will be a day when he pierces through the clouds, and his eyes will be like a raging fire, because he will be coming for his people. For those that have called upon his name, that is you. And if you haven't, it can be you. Lord, this morning, as we recognize your presence and your goodness, we have come today to hear from you. Lord, you know of the requests today. You know those things that we've had to deal with this past week or that's waiting for us tomorrow. And yet in the midst of all of that, we are stopping. Time is standing still as we enter into your presence, allowing you to speak into our lives, to remind us that we're not alone, that you have a plan for us and a purpose, that this whole thing isn't an accident, but it's intentional. You have a plan, and you are coming for your people to redeem them, to restore them, and to make them holy. Lord, may you have your way in this time and in this place. We're asking for your will to be done. And Lord, on this day, we're going to give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And all the kids are dismissed to Children's Kids Grove. I do have just a couple announcements as they're heading out. Ezra's birthday, Tucker's birthday, and Sarah's birthday, right? So can we just give them both a hand? Yeah, she's inconspicuously drinking her coffee. This is, what do we got going on here? Oh, two things. Marriage retreat. So you can continue to sign up for that, but I was contacted by the hotel, and they said this is the last week they can hold those rooms open. So past this week, you can still register. You can still go up. You just probably won't be able to stay at the Perry where the event's taking place. Because people are calling all the time. She said more than likely it'll be full. So this week, they are holding block rooms for us at a discounted price one more week. So if you're thinking about doing it, please give them a call. Membership classes, Welcome Center, you'll see a sign up if you're interested in becoming a member or just learning more about the church. It's going to be during the Sunday school hour. This here is a thank you note I wanted to read to the church. Dear Cherry Grove Church of the Nazarene, on behalf of Forest View staff and the family of our student, thank you so much from the bottom of our hearts for your generous donation. Our staff and our students and families are just so blessed to to have a wonderful relationship with your church. That from a public school. Thank you so much. You know, it's not always easy, and not many of us here have just like a lot of money overflowing or time, and yet your willingness to help financially, your willingness to help to be a mentor to these students are making a difference. So thank you. Yes. All right. Draw your swords and turn to John chapter 8. John chapter 8. We're going to be looking at verse 12 in just a minute. 1847, something happened. Someone was born. An inventor, a scientist, a businessman. Very good. Yes, Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison. You jumped the gun there, but yes, you're right. Thomas Edison. Probably one of the competitors to Nikola Tesla. But we would know him, you know, all of his inventions. Obviously, probably the most widely known is the one that changed most of the world. And that is the electric light or the light bulb. Now, that didn't happen by accident as he was going through experiment after experiment. In fact, he said thousands of different experiments to try to get the right filament to make the light bulb. Now, we know he would use a piece of carbon, and I believe that first one would burn. If he found out that if he had a piece of carbon in a vacuum, the bulb, it would burn for 40 hours. After many, many more experiments, he found out that if he made the filament into a U, it would burn 2.5 times longer, so it would burn about 100 hours. But it wasn't until him and his staff, however big that was, they went to Wyoming to watch a total eclipse. And during the total eclipse, he happened to have his bamboo fishing pole next to him. And you could say the light bulb went off because some strands of bamboo were sticking out, and he went back and began carbonizing the bamboo. And it wouldn't burn for 40 hours or for 100 hours. It would burn for 1,500 hours. I think the year then at that point was 1878. He went back and did some more experimentation in the park. I think the name was Mesla Park or Mella Park, something very close to that. Thank you. Thank you, John. Yes. If you're unsure about something, you ask John, and he can confirm or deny it. So he's at the park, and they were setting up this grand reveal. Thousands of people had come because they had heard Thomas Edison, a.k.a., you know what his nickname was? The Wizard. That's pretty cool. That'd actually be a cool trail name. Yeah, I mean, okay. So he's doing this. He wires up a half a mile long. Now, remember, at this time, you lit your house usually either by some sort of gas light or candlelight. And most people, it was just candles. He was going to light up the entire park. And as thousands of people gathered around and the sun was beginning to set at dusk, he flips the switch. And as one spectator says in one word, magical, and the entire park lit up, and the eyes of man was opened like never before. Well, 1,800 years before that, another light would pierce the darkness, and it would pierce the darkness in such a way that man wasn't just able to see for a few hours, but man was able to see now for eternity. Look with me this morning at John chapter 8 as we continue our series in the I Ams, where Jesus now declares, I am the light of the world. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. The Pharisees challenged him. Here you are, appearing as your own witness. Your testimony is not valid. Jesus answered, even if I testify on my own behalf, my testimony is valid. For I know where I come from and where I am going. But you have no idea where I come from or where I'm going. You judge by human standards. I pass judgment on no one. But if I do judge, my decisions are true because I am not alone. I stand with the Father who sent me. In your law, it is written that testimony of two witnesses is true. I am one who testifies for myself, and my other witness is the Father who sent me. Then they asked him, where is your Father? You do not know me, or my Father, Jesus replied. For if you knew me, you would know my Father also. He spoke these words while teaching in the temple courts near the place where the offerings were put. Yet no one seized him because his hour had not yet come. Jesus is now at the temple, and we've got a picture of the temple we're going to put up here. Jesus is here, and we know from verse 20 that we just read, it says that he was at the place where the offerings were put. So what does that mean? That means, if you can see this here, he is in the court of women. You see that right over here? Court of women. Okay, so this is an overview or a view from an aerial, from the top, of the temple. This here down here is part of the temple. That's where the Gentiles could worship. They could go no further. And then the women's court was here. Now, when we say women, it wasn't just women in the women's courtyard right there. Okay, this is really where most of the activity took place, because in this colonnade, and that's what these little circles are, it's like a portico. You see here, right here, these little circles. This is also where people would give their offerings. So surrounding the women's court were 13 treasure chests, kind of hard to read, but those say right there, those say treasure chest. Those surrounded the women's courtyard, right there, treasure chests. And each chest, they were called trumpets, because the chest swooped up and bowled out kind of like a trumpet, and you'd put your offering in it. And each trumpet had its own offering. So one trumpet might be for the temple. Another one could be for a woman. She would make an offering after having a child, purification offering that would pay for a pigeon. One was for the upkeep of the gold articles within the temple. One was to help pay for the wood on the altar. Another was for the incense that was burned day and night. So there was a lot of different offerings that had to take place. And so the traffic of the court, there was just a flow of people coming in and out of the court. And Jesus is here in the court of women. It would be a perfect place to gather people to have a teaching. But as he is here, he sees something. And it wasn't just because this was a good location to teach the people. He has something else in mind. And he would make a statement. He would say, I am the light of the world. Now, we hear that statement, and we don't think that that's very controversial. It doesn't sound too over the top. But I want you to picture what is going on when he makes this statement. Because when he says that, he is here during a particular festival. It is the Feast of Light. Oh, that's a great guess. That would be negative. It was the Feast of Tabernacles. This is one of the three major feasts. And why this is important. People annually would leave during Tishri or Tishra, that was like September, October, to come down to the temple to celebrate. During that time, they would live in little booths, think of tents, for the week. They did that to commemorate that their ancestors, when they were slaves in Egypt and left, they lived in these little booths for 40 years. And so it was a way to remember. Now, that day, they came and they're celebrating this. They're also celebrating the illumination ceremony, which was the first day. Now, what led the Israelites during the day and during the night? Yes, Jacinda, you're right again. She is on a roll. A pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire at night. I've often wondered, what was that like? Was it a small light? Was it a large light? Was that flame yellow? Was the flame blue? At nighttime, in the cool of the evening, did the flame radiate heat? We're not for sure, because Scripture really doesn't go into that, but what we do know is when they saw that flame and the pillar going up, it was the presence of God. At the Feast of Tabernacles, it doesn't show here, but there were four candelabras. Okay? And this is, I'm not sure, but here's my guess. My guess is they were on the corner. So one there, one there, one there, one there. Okay? So you see that? We got one here, one there, one there, one there. Four of them. Jesus is in the court of women. And whether this was on that day, right before that day, or after that day, my guess is he's looking at these four great candelabras that stood. Are you ready for this? It stood 75 feet high. Now, when we look at this, you know, it, you know, a little bit of a brew pen of a house, kind of, and it doesn't look very big. To give you a perspective, this court, a room, was 1 acre in size. We measure our room in feet. We don't measure things in acres in a house or a room or a building. That is 1 acre in that room. These candelabras are standing at 75 feet. And when people came for that first day, that illumination Sunday or that illumination evening, and they lit those, can you imagine what it must have looked like? It would be like a flaming torch just going up to the sky, and we're told that the light would spill over each wall into the next courtyard and then into the next courtyard. And some people say that it even illuminated the entire city of Jerusalem from those four candles. Jesus is there, the crowd has gathered, and he looks over at the lights and then back at the people as the religious leaders are looking on, and he says this, "I am the light of the world." Now, we're not told really the entire event. My guess is that the religious leaders went absolutely crazy because they know what he's saying. And the very first thing in their reply is this. They say this, "Oh, here you are, you're trying to appear as one of your own witnesses." Let me paraphrase that. They are trying to discredit Jesus because they know what he's saying and they don't want anybody else to listen to him. You see, two things that the religious leaders were doing. One, they're trying to discredit so no one listens to them. The other is they had their own preconceived ideas of who Jesus was, and he wasn't fitting those ideas. I wonder sometimes if we kind of do the same thing. I mean, we really have it. We do it in life. We have preconceived ideas, right? I have preconceived ideas. I have preconceived ideas of where things should be in the refrigerator. And my wife can verify this. I'll give you an example. I am a blind guide when it comes to the refrigerator. I open up the refrigerator the other day, and I'm looking for my salmon, because that's usually what I have for lunch, salmon or chicken. And the salmon is not there. I then leave the refrigerator, and I come back to the refrigerator because I know it's in there. And I open it up again, and it's not there. I then go downstairs, and I look in that refrigerator, and it's not down there. So I come back up a third time, and I open up the refrigerator, and it's not there. Finally, I go to Carrie, and I say, "Where's my salmon at? I can't find it." She walks over, as compassionate and kind as a wife can be, who knows exactly where it is. She opens up the door and she says, "It's right here." Now, I will say this. I think she intentionally hides things on me because it's not on top. She had something else on top of my salmon, and I wasn't expecting it to be underneath something else. But my preconceived ideas of where it should be caused me to be blind to what was right in front of me. The religious leaders, because they had preconceived ideas of Jesus, missed the very one they were waiting for. And we have to be careful, because sometimes we have a preconceived idea of who Jesus should be, and we miss what he's trying to tell us. And so now he speaks up, and he says this. He says, "I am the light of the world, and whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." There's another picture we're going to show, because I think this is what it looked like during the illumination ceremony. I don't know, it's not real clear, but in that picture, those candelabras actually stand higher than the walls. And when Jesus, if you like to take notes or write in your Bible, I want you to write this down, because when he uses the word light, here is the Greek word he uses. It is phos, which means to reveal that which is hidden. Did you get that? Write that down. To reveal that which is hidden. And then he attaches this: "For those who accept my light, they will have life." And the word there is zoe, which means real and genuine. Or to say it another way, invigorated by the illumination of God. Real and genuine, or invigorated by the illumination of God. So, let me paraphrase that verse. Jesus is saying, "I am the light of the world. For as the light begins to illuminate the rooms during the illumination ceremony, and the walls and the courtyards cannot contain it, for it begins pouring over the walls into the next, like a tidal wave, it cannot be stopped. And as the great candles are lit and the light begins unveiling everything, it shows you where you are. It shows you the corners of the room. It cannot be contained. I now am the light that will reveal your world to you and reveal your heart. And you may not like what you see, but I have come not just to reveal what's in your heart, but to make you holy." I think sometimes our preconceived ideas of who God is that he's just a God of judgment. You know, in the military, they break you down, right? To build you up. To make you a new person. So that you're fit for what you need to do. So that you're fit for duty. God wants to make you fit for duty. And before you are, there are some things you have to deal with inside of your heart. Like the Pharisees, we too can simply just reject Jesus. We can refuse him, refuse to accept him, the illumination he might be revealing to us, or we can come up with our own ideas of who he is. You know, there's a word that is sometimes used, because really what Jesus wants to do is not just save you so you get to heaven, but he wants to sanctify you. That is, to make you sacred. Because that's how precious you are to him. I'm going to read, as I believe this was read during the illumination ceremony, and we've got a kind of a view of what that pillar of fire might have looked like. This is coming from Exodus. When Pharaoh let the people go, God did not lead them on the road through the Philistine country, though that was shorter, for God said if they face war, they might change their minds. So God led the people around by the desert road toward the Red Sea, and the Israelites went out of Egypt armed for battle. Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, because Joseph had made the sons of Israel swear an oath. He said, God will come to your aid, and when he does, carry my bones up out of this place. And leaving the desert, by day the Lord went ahead of them, and a pillar of cloud to guide them on their way, and by night in a pillar of fire to travel by night. For neither the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night left its place from the people. And when the king saw that the people had fled, Pharaoh and his officials changed their minds and said, what have we done? We have let the Israelites go and have lost our slaves. So he had his chariots made ready. He took 600 of his best chariots. But the Lord hardened his heart. The Egyptians and all of Pharaoh's horses and chariots and horsemen and troops pursued the Israelites, overtook them as they camped near Pi Hahiroth. And as Pharaoh approached, the Israelites looked, and there was the Egyptians marching after them, and they were terrified. They looked to Moses and said, was it because there was no graves in Egypt that you have brought us out to the desert to die? Didn't we say, just leave us alone, let us serve the Egyptians as slaves? But Moses answered the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm, and you will see the deliverance of the Lord that he will bring to you this day. The Egyptians you see today will never be seen again. For the Lord will fight for you. You only need to be still. The Egyptians pursued with the horses and chariots and the horsemen. And during the last watch of night, the Lord looked down from that pillar of fire. And he made the wheels of the chariots come off so that they had difficulty driving. And the Egyptians said, we must get away, for the Lord is fighting for them. And then the Lord said to Moses, stretch out your hand over the sea so that the waters may flow back on the Egyptians. And Moses stretched out his hand on the sea, and the sea went back to its place. The Egyptians were fleeing from it, but the Lord swept them into the sea, and the water flowed back, covering the chariots and the horsemen. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed the Israelites went into the sea, and no one survived. But the Israelites went through that sea on dry ground, with a wall of water to the right and on their left, For that day the Lord saved them from the hands of the Egyptians. And Israel, they saw that the Egyptians were lying on the shore. And when the Israelites saw the great power of the Lord displayed against the Egyptians, it was then that the people feared the Lord and then put their trust in Him. Jesus looks at those candles, and the illumination goes up, and He declares before all that were present. He doesn't say, "I am like that light. I'm kind of like a light." They knew that the presence of God was in the pillar of fire. And He now says, "I am He. And I have come for you. Will you let me lead you to the promised land?" Would you please stand? I don't know what ideas you have of who God is, or looking at life thinking maybe God is somehow punishing you, or you can't be forgiven, or this is just the way you are. But you see, God didn't do all of that just to leave you. He did all of that to make you whole. And yes, there will be hardships along the way. There was hardships for the Israelites. That's why they cried out, "We wish we just would have been slaves and stayed there." But He was trying to show them a better way. You see, Pharaoh and the Egyptians chasing after the people, well, that is sin. Sin wants to keep you captive. It wants to hold you. It wants to lie to you and to tell you you can't change. You're better off just the way you are. And yet God wants to separate the waters and do something miraculous in your life. He wants you to take that next step in your faith journey, to sanctify you, to begin making you holy, cleansing you, revealing things in your heart that maybe you don't even want to deal with. But if you're willing, through His help, you can overcome. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. And through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. Why? Because in Him was life. And that life was the light of men, and the light will shine in the darkness. But the darkness has not understood it. He was in the world, and though the world was made through Him, the world did not recognize Him. He came to that which was His own, but His own did not receive Him. Yet, to all who have received Him, to those who believe in His name, He gave them the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. For the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us, and we have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace, truth, and light. Would you bow your heads? Maybe this morning the Holy Spirit is speaking to you and you don't even know what that means. You just know something needs to change. You can feel Him tugging at you. Are you willing to take that next step? Are you willing to allow Him to begin sanctifying you? If you are, would you raise your hand? Because I want to pray for you this week. God's got a plan for you. It's not to leave you where you are, but it's to set you free. Lord, this morning I am reminded of how good you are. Oh, the darkness wants to keep us there. It wants to bind us and hold us down. But like those great candles, the light cannot be contained. Lord, we recognize that we have to meet you. Would you help us to take those next steps in our faith? Maybe that means being more intentional in our time with you and in your word, and praying, reading it, letting you speak to us, maybe journaling about it. However that looks, help us to do what we need to do so that you can do what you need to do. And we trust you and we believe you that you will not leave us the same. For you have illuminated our hearts and the transformation has begun. So Lord, this morning we are praising you not only for what you have done, but what you're doing and what you're going to continue to do until you break through those clouds on the white horse with a light that pierces the darkness and with a shout that is hard to even explain or comprehend. We will hear those words and you will call us. It is time to come home. But until then, Lord, help us to be faithful to you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, Amen.
First thing in the morning, till the end of the day, there's a heavenly little melody to the rhythm of your praise. And I give you my heart and something's different ever since. I can't keep hallelujah off my lips now.
You make me wanna sing all about your love. You make me wanna tell the whole world what you've done. How you turned my life around. I was lost but now I'm found. You're the song stuck inside my head.